Students, in the previous video lecture, we already have derived equation for radius, right? Using that, we will solve this problem. R is equal to R naught a power 1/3. R naught is equal to 1.2 into 10 power minus 15 meter. You are now supposed to calculate, compare the radii of nuclei of mass number 27 and 64. A1 is equal to 27, A2 is equal to 64. These are the two, A1 and A2 are the two mass numbers given. You are now supposed to find out, you are supposed to compare the radii of nuclei of mass number 27 and 64. I can write R1 divided by R2 is equal to A1 power 1/3 divided by A2 power 1/3. A1 is 27, A2 is 64 whole power 1/3. 27 can be written as 3 cube. 64 can be written as 4 cube 1/3. This is equal to 3/4. So ratio of the radii R1 is to R2 is 3:4. Radius of oxygen nucleus in this question is given 2.8 into 10 power minus 15 meter. You should find out radius of lead. We have basic relation R1 divided by R2 is equal to A1 divided by A2 whole power 1/3. A1 is oxygen, it is 16 divided by A2 is lead, it is 205 whole power 1/3. R0 is oxygen, you can just write it as 2.8 into 10 power minus 15 divided by R2 is equal to 16 divided by 205 whole power 1/3. From here, you can calculate R2 and nearly it will be 6.55 into 10 power minus 15 meter. This is the radius of lead nucleus unit. Now let us discuss the definition of atomic mass unit, which we will be using in order to calculate mass defect and also mass of the nucleons present within the nucleus. Atomic mass unit, which is in short called as AMU, the masses of atoms, the masses of atoms, nuclei and subatomic particles, they are very, very small. They are minute particles, right? They are very small. Hence, a small unit is used to express their mass, because you cannot use gram or kg in this case, because the masses of these particles are very, very small. They are minute. So hence, a unit named atomic mass unit is defined in order to calculate masses of these minute microscopical nuclear particles. So one AMU is defined as 1/12th part of a neutral carbon 6-12 atom. And one AMU is nearly equal to 1.67 into 10 power minus 27 kg, which is nearly equal to mass of proton, which is equal to mass of proton. This is 1 AMU. 1 AMU is one atomic mass unit. One atomic mass unit is 1/12th portion of a neutral carbon atom. Neutral carbon atom has 6 protons and 6 neutrons. Its total mass is 12. So if you divide its mass number with 12, obviously you will be getting 1, which is nearly equal to mass of the proton. So 1 AMU is simply written as 1.67 into 10 power minus 27 kg, that is equal to mass of the proton. So students, we know that in a nucleus, let me take, this is a nucleus, and in nucleus there are nuclear particles. These all are nuclear particles where they are protons, neutrons, these are nucleons, and nucleons are protons and neutrons. Proton have positive charge, it is plus 1.6 into 10 power minus 19 coulomb. So when we have learned, proton have a repulsive force, that means two positive charges should have a repulsive force, and that repulsive force is K into Q square divided by R square. That is the repulsive force acting between two positive charges inside a nucleus. Not only in nucleus, in any between two charged particles, if they are being situated at any position, definitely there will be a repulsive force acting between them. Now, because of these repulsive force, actually the two nuclear particles should have a repulsive force such that the size of the nucleus should go on increase. Say for example, if you are considering hydrogen, it have only one proton. If you are considering carbon, it have only 6 protons. Likewise, as the atomic number increases, say for example, you have zinc, its atomic number is 30, so therefore it have 30 protons. Likewise, uranium, its atomic number is 92, so there will be 92 protons. As the number of protons are increasing within the nucleus, the repulsive force also should increase. As the repulsive force is increasing, the size of nucleus should go on increasing, but it is not happening so. The size of carbon is in the order of, carbon nucleus is in the order of 10 power minus 15, and the size of uranium nucleus is also in the order of 10 power minus 15. Very slight deviation, but order is 10 power minus 15, that remains same. Then how come it's possible? If we are considering protons, there should be a repulsive force, and that repulsive force should increase the size of the nucleus, but it is not happening so. All nuclear size is comparable with each other. They are nearly 10 power minus 15 meter or 1 Fermi. That means there should be a compensating force. There should be a compensating force which compress or which balance the repulsive force acting between two positive charges. Is it not? Because of repulsive force, the nuclear size should increase, but it is not happening so. It is because there might be some another force which is pushing these two nuclear particles or protons such that its force, that force is dominating than that of electrostatic force. Usually electrostatic force itself is greater force, it is greater magnitude than that of gravitational force. But still greater magnitude force might be coming into action, and it is pulling the two protons closer to each other, which dominates the force of electrostatics. Therefore, here the different kind of force which is acting in such a way, a nucleus is being bound such that all the nuclear particles which are present within the nucleus, they are being bound together with each other such that the size of the nucleus will remain same. Such force which bind the nucleons, all nucleons, irrespective of the charge, is said to be a nuclear force. So a nuclear force is that force which act between two nuclear particles, irrespective of the charge. As the atomic number goes on increases, the proton-proton repulsion increases. In order to increase the attractive force, which should bind the nucleus such that its size should not increase, there must be some another nucleon particles which may be present within the nucleus, and those particles are called neutrons. So neutrons are being introduced in order to balance the nuclear, in order to balance the repulsive force acting between the charged particles, protons. As nucleons, irrespective of the charge, it can be a proton or it can be a neutron. The attractive force act between nucleons, which compensate and which dominate electrostatic repulsive force acting between two charged particles. So that force which bind the nucleus is said to be, that force which bind the nucleus is said to be a nuclear force. And this nuclear force is the attractive force, and it bind the nucleons together. And there are few properties of nuclear force, and those properties are: number one, nuclear force is the strongest force in nature. Out of four fundamental forces, we have four fundamental forces: electrostatic force, gravitational force, nuclear force, weak nuclear force. Out of these four fundamental forces, nuclear force itself is the strongest force in nature, and it is about 10 power 38 times as strong as gravitational force. The relative strength of gravitational force and electrostatic force and the nuclear force is in the order 1:10^36 to 10^38. This is gravitational force, it is electrostatic force, and it is nuclear force. Nuclear force is at 10^38 times greater than gravitational force, and 10^2 times greater than that of electrostatic force. That's number one. Number two is, nuclear force are short range forces. Short range force in the sense, the range of the nuclear force is very minimum. It is within the vicinity of nucleus. Outside the nucleus, there will be no such nuclear force, because outside the nucleus, there are no nucleons. Nucleons are always present inside the nucleus. Therefore, inside the nucleus itself, such nuclear forces comes to action. Outside the nucleus, there are no such nuclear force. Therefore, the range of nuclear force is of order 10^-15 meter, or you can just call it as 1 Fermi. And number three is that nuclear force are basically strong attractive force. Nuclear force is basically strong attractive forces, but contain a small component of repulsive forces. Of course, these are always attractive force, and they are strong, very strong attractive forces, which is much greater than that of electrostatic force attraction and as well as gravitational force. But there will be slight repulsive force acting between two nucleons, but however, the attraction magnitude is much greater than that of repulsive force. That's the reason why nuclear force is able to bind the nucleus. And why that repulsive force is acting between two nucleons, there is reason for that. We will discuss that in mass defect. Coming to number four, nuclear forces are saturated forces. Nuclear forces are saturated forces, and their range is very small. Of course, I already told you the range of the nuclear force is very small. So for example, if I am taking a nucleon, like within the nucleus, there are this is one nucleon, and this is another nucleon, this is another nucleon, this is another nucleon, and this is another nucleon, this is another nucleon, this is another nucleon, and this is another nucleon. Outside, like beyond this, there are other nucleons. This is one nucleon, this is one nucleon, this is one nucleon. The nuclear force are saturated force. It means that the nucleus, the nucleon force is able to share its force with these two, between 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 these two. The blue color nucleon, which I have marked here, cannot share its force with the green color nucleon, which is just out of that blue color. So between blue color nucleon and green color nucleon, there is one more nucleon, which is red color. So saturated force means that the force which is restricted only for one layer, only up to certain range, it is said to be saturated force. So nuclear force is always saturated force. It can act between two nucleons which are just surrounded by that nucleon, not any nucleon present out somewhere. Like this nucleon which is present here cannot share its force with this nucleon. There is no force acting between these two. Its immediate nucleon only it can attract. That's how you can consider nuclear force is a saturated force, and nuclear force is charge independent. It is irrespective of the charge. Between proton and proton, whatever the force is there, between proton and neutron, same force will be there. Between a neutron and neutron, there will be same force. It is irrespective of the charge. Between all the nucleons, the nuclear force is the same. It does not depend upon the charge. It is a charge independent. And one more important character of nuclear force is it is a spin dependent. It is charge independent and it is a spin dependent. Nuclear force is a spin dependent. We have spin quantum number, which is introduced in atomic structure, positive spin and negative spin. That means a nucleon can rotate in clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction. Based on the rotation of the nucleus, the nuclear force may be dependent upon. Therefore, it is said to be spin dependent. And the seventh property is nuclear forces are exchange forces. That means nuclear force acting between two nucleons can exchange few particles. Say, for example, there is one nucleon here, there is another nucleon here. This nucleon will share its particle, some particle with the other nucleon. So between these two, there is generally, there are nuclear particles exchanged between them. Therefore, nuclear forces are exchange forces. Usually they exchange mesons, they exchange leptons, and they exchange baryons. These all are called nuclear particles. There are many nuclear particles present within the nucleus. So whenever there is a force acting between two nucleons, they generally exchange meson particles such that the interaction between them become very strong. And the eighth character of nucleus is that nuclear force are non-central forces. They are non-central forces. Usually central force is that gravitational force is a central force. Electrostatic force is a central force. But nuclear force is non-central force. This does not act along the line joining between two nucleons at any distance. They will be always acting only between two nucleons which are just side by side, and they are not inversely proportional to r power n. Nuclear forces are not inversely proportional to r power n. Usually such type of forces, they are called central forces. Gravitational force F is inversely proportional to r square. Electrostatic force, magnetic force, they become central because they are always inversely proportional to r power n. But here it is not like that. They are not inversely proportional to r power n. Therefore, nuclear forces are non-central forces. These all are the characteristics of nuclear force. which make nuclear force unique than that of all other fundamental forces acting between the particles. Students, we already have learned that between two nucleons there will be a nuclear force, and that nuclear force is responsible in binding the nucleons. But from where does this force come, and how, why it is having this much amount of energy such that it is able to bind the nucleus with very large energy? It is reason mass defect. Because of mass defect, the mass gets converted into energy, and that energy will provide force which bind the nucleus. We will discuss what is meant by mass defect, binding energy, and how Einstein have given mass energy relation. We are going to now learn in this particular slide. As we already know that every nucleus is made up of like some protons and neutrons, I'll be taking one example, say helium 2, 4, okay? And the mass number of helium, it is a 4. Mass number of helium is 4 and atomic number of helium is 2. As we know, mass of the proton is 1.0078 amu. I'm writing it in terms of amu. Mass of neutron is 1.0087 amu. If you calculate total masses of the constituents of this helium, helium have 2 proton and 2 neutron. Therefore, mass of constituents of nucleus is 2 times mass of the proton plus 2 times mass of the neutron. This gives you total masses of the constituents. So masses of the constituents is 2 times 1.0078 amu plus 2 times 1.0087 amu. And if you calculate this, nearly you will be getting 4.0332 amu. This is masses of the constituents of the nucleus. Likewise, if you just measure mass of the nucleus, mass of helium 2, 4 as a whole is 4.028 amu, right? So actually, why is the mass obtained for the nucleus? It is because of presence of protons and neutrons. So when we calculate individually masses of the constituents of the nucleus, you are getting 4.0332 amu, which is in contradiction with practically found mass of the helium. Practically found mass of the helium is 4.028 amu, nearly. So there is imbalance between mass of the whole nucleus and with masses of the constituents present within that nucleus. Same helium nucleus, if you are calculating mass of the constituents, you are getting this. But as a whole, if you are measuring the nuclear mass, you are getting this. There is a discrepancy between mass of the constituents and mass of the nucleus. So I'll just calculate how much is the discrepancy between mass of the nucleus and mass of the constituents. So this is delta M, which is mass of constituents minus mass of nucleus, which is equal to 4.033 minus 4.028. I'm rounding it off to only 3 decimal points. This is nearly equal to 0.0006 6 AMU. That is nearly 0.006 AMU. And this is delta M. Delta M, which is 0.006. I think it's 5, right? So it's 5, not 6, it's 5. 0.005 AMU. This is approximate value. So when we are calculating mass defect, like the discrepancy between constituents of the nucleus with actual mass of the nucleus, there is a slight defect observed. And this defect or this discrepancy between constituents of the nucleus and actual mass of the nucleus is termed as mass defect. It is termed as mass defect. Mass defect is defined as the difference of mass of the constituents and actual mass of the nucleus. So I can just write it as delta M is equal to Z times mass of protons, because the total number of protons present within the nucleus is Z, plus total number of neutrons present within the nucleus is A minus Z, and that is mass of the neutron minus XZA. This is equation for mass defect of the nucleus. So mass defect delta M is Z times mass of the proton plus A minus Z times mass of the neutrons as a whole minus actual mass of the nucleus. Actual mass of the nucleus is XZA, where Z is its atomic number, A is mass number. And we can define mass defect per nucleon. Mass defect per nucleon is equal to delta M divided by A, which is equal to Z times mass of the proton plus A minus Z times mass of the neutron minus XZA divided by A. This is mass defect per nucleon.